Welcome to Cradle and All, a podcast hosted by sisters Renita and Christine to educate, inspire, and connect with other mothers. Every other week, listen as we discuss topics related to pregnancy, raising children, and balancing motherhood with other aspects of womanhood. Whether you're relaxing, juggling tasks, or even breast pumping, join us as we figure it out together. Hi, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of Cradle and All. This is your host, Christine.
Hey, it's Renita. Welcome back. We are talking all about sleep with kids.
Yes. Yeah, sleeping, getting some rest, which I used to love sleeping. I still do, but I'm learning that the older I get, the less value I should put on sleep. According to society, I need to be getting up at 5 a.m.
Well, so. No, okay, listen. You can get up at 5 a.m., but you still need to get sleep at night. So sleep is still important. Like, I feel like I still get a good night's sleep, even though I wake up early.
Yes, children are not the only ones who should be getting peaceful and copious amounts of sleep. It's not fair. We all need it.
Oh my gosh. Well, you know, since we've had our kids, I've always said, oh, I'm so lucky my kids sleep well and I don't know what I'm doing. But I feel like the tables have turned recently because both Jackson and Russell are waking up at the wrong times and messing up my good sleep. Because like last night, for example, so finally we put both of the kids to sleep and Jack, Bryson and I are watching a movie and all of a sudden the door opens, but like you can't see anybody because it was Russell and he was like so short. And I was like, oh my gosh, what's going on? I thought it was Nala, our dog, who pushed the door in. And here comes Russell acting like he didn't just crawl out of his crib and was just like, hey, couch in our room. And we were like, what are you doing? You need to go to bed. So then finally do all the routines again to get him back to sleep, reading another book, saying all the kisses and things that we have to do before bed, get back in the bed. And here comes Jackson now. And he's like, I had a nightmare. Gosh. And it's been like an hour. So there was another 30 minutes of putting a second child down to bed for the second time that night. I was like, this is crazy.
Yeah, that is a bit much, but that's not usual for your family. You guys are pretty consistent when it comes to sleep. Your kids go down pretty easily and stay down. Whereas last night was just another night of the same thing for us, where Dallas, he goes down pretty easily. He's been a rule follower when it comes to sleeping. We put him down. He gets up one time and he says, I can't sleep. He said something like, give some excuse, you know, the stalling. So he's stalling. He gives some excuse about why he can't sleep. You didn't cover me up, whatever. He goes back down. He's fine. Whereas Dakota, every single night, it's the same. When he goes to bed, he cries and cries and cries. Keep in mind, he's like 2 and a half almost. And he's been doing this since he turned 2. And so I'm like, when will this end? He still cries every single night. And the thing that's the most frustrating is that my husband can get him down so much easier than me. When Dontrell goes in the room, Dakota sees him coming, he leaps back into the bed from lying on the ground. With me, I come in, he digs his heels in. He'll lie halfway on the bed. I'll say, lie down. He'll just look at me. Lie down. He'll look at me. He just does not listen, which is the most frustrating thing ever. So,
you know, that's why I'm so happy that we had our talk today with our sleep consultant who yes. talked to us about all the tips on how to get our kids to bed, how to help them stay in bed, all those things.
Yeah. I mean, she is so incredible. I'm considering hiring her, but actually I feel like she gave so many great ideas, not even ideas, but real tips and solutions that I'm trying tonight. I mean, when it comes to toddlers, and not only toddlers, but if you have a newborn, an infant, anyone between the age of 0 to 5 years old, this conversation is going to be so helpful for you because there's something, a nugget in here that will help you because nobody's got it figured out. I'm sure this Ensley, who's our guest today, she has 4 children. And I wanted to ask her, like, so is your home just like a peaceful haven at nighttime?
Everyone's sleeping peacefully at night. Yeah. All night. Well, like I say, it's not selfish. It's self-care to make sure that you're getting good sleep. And I love the premise of her organization where they want to make sure that the parents are sleeping well. And that starts with getting the kids down. So I hope you guys enjoy this episode because we definitely enjoy talking to her.
We are so excited because we're joined today by an incredible guest, Ensley Nesbitt, who is the co-owner of Sleep Baby Consulting, is joining us today. Welcome, Ensley.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited.
Yes, and we're so excited to have you because sleep is one of my all-time favorite things. Before I had kids, I would get 8 hours. And so this is so exciting. I know we invited you to join. I think this is something that all moms, all parents have to figure out as a new parent. So we are so excited for this conversation today to hear from you, your expertise and knowledge. But before we dive in, we'd love for you just to introduce yourself to the listeners today. Who are you? What is Sleep Baby Consulting?
All right. Well, I'm Ensley. I am a mother of 4 lovely children and a wife here in the Atlanta area. And Sleep Baby Consulting is a business that was started out of the need for a mom needing good sleep. So our founder, Elizabeth, had the exact same need. And so she started helping friends and then she decided to open a business and start helping these friends that she was already unofficially helping. And with that, she grew the team and I came on after a couple of years and we just clicked and hit it off. And so I decided to become one of the co-owners and we are just continuing to grow our companies nationwide. We have consultants all over the US and our main focus is to help and empower parents and allow their babies to get a good sleep. But really we're here mostly for the parents because we know in order to be our best selves, we need to feel well-rested, rejuvenated. So that's really what we're here for.
That is so awesome. You know, when we were planning on having this episode, I was talking to my husband and I was like, okay, we were both exhausted. We had some issues getting our little two down. I was like, what questions would you want to have answered? Because everybody is desperate to get some good sleep. How did you get into this line of work in general?
Yeah. So I actually got into this because I was a teacher in the past. And when I was pregnant with my second daughter, I was looking for something where I could continue to educate families. I could do my passion of teaching, but I really wanted to be more available for my family. So we actually, my husband and I bought a small little nursery school in Roswell, Georgia, and I started running that. And one of the things I noticed was such a need was that families really needed help structuring their baby's day in order for their baby to come home happy and optimize their daycare day, come home well-rested. And I always wanted to hand a baby back to a parent, the most rested and happy baby I could. So we kind of redeveloped what our philosophy was at the daycare and put sleep at the center of it. And so that really pivoted me into why am I not doing this on a different professional level? I love helping the families we have here, but how can I continue to help and serve moms? And so that is where I really started diving into the science of sleep and really learning about the rhythms and the patterns and biologically what babies are born to do. And I was like, I can do this. I can get paid for this. I learned the science. And then I was like, I really want to be with a company who I get as a mom. And so that led me down the quest of finding a business model that I agreed with. And that's what led me to Sleep Baby.
Awesome. I love that. So I love that thought of like putting sleep at the focus of your center, because I've never heard of that before, but it's such an important, it's such a big part of a child and infant's life is sleep when they're at a certain age. So that's really interesting. I'm glad that you explained it that way. So a lot of folks may not be familiar with what a sleep consultant is or does. Can you tell us more about what your role is with a family? Like, what would you do? Let's say I was like, hey, Ensley, I need your help. Can you please work with my family? Like, what would my experience be like if I worked with you or another sleep consultant?
Yeah, absolutely. I definitely gear my philosophy in Sleep Baby, all of our consultants do, around what the family is looking for. So we look at where you are in your sleep journey, and then we also take in mind what's developmentally appropriate for the baby and what sleep could potentially look like if everything was optimal. And so we really, but everyone doesn't live an optimal life. Kids are in daycare. There's, you know, carpool, all these other pieces. So we look at where your family is on your sleep journey and then create a custom program that's based on your family. So with people, I feel like sleep consultants have kind of gotten a bad rap because people often think, oh, they're just going to tell me to cry it out. And that is not the case. There are a bunch of different ways to sleep train. Yep. And so looking, we do an intake form where we get to know your family. It's a very detailed questionnaire and it asks questions about crying, what your daily schedule looks like, your optimal wake up time, your optimal bedtime. And then we look at those in the restraints of what a healthy sleeper does or should do. And we develop a plan that's based on your family. So we work from newborns to age 5, taking into consideration the science of sleep is really at the forefront of what we do, but then putting your family in routine and knowing that every day is not going to be perfect, but how do you pivot? And when days can be good, how do we achieve that? And then also sleep is a skill. So we really talk about how to lay the foundation with the sleep. We call them the building blocks of sleep. We talk about good sleep hygiene, and that can be started at birth. And then we really talk about the sleep skills that are acquired by a baby and how to teach them that.
Wow. That's really great. Now, when are the times that you see people come to you the most? For example, I know for us starting off as parents, my husband and I, we were facing issues with sleep in the moment, almost like in a crisis way. So in the beginning, when we were dealing with swaddling, we're up in the middle of the night Googling, or in times where my son's having some regression and we're like looking things up on YouTube. So when do you tend to encounter your clients? When are they coming to see you and what are they coming to see you for?
Yeah. So I think clients come to us at all different ages. We have some people that their OBGYN or their future pediatrician recommend that they start learning about sleep. Those are the clients who obviously probably are like me as a mom, who sleep was like one of the number one priorities in my life. And I was like, I've got to have a baby that can sleep, yes. which is what led me down that journey as a first time mom. Like that was probably one of the first things I started researching, because I'm like, in the airplane, they say, put your air mask on first. Like that was going to be me with sleep. Like I knew I was going to have to sacrifice sleep, but like, how could I have a healthy baby that's also sleeping? So I think the 4-month sleep regression has a big like talk in the parent community. So I feel like a lot of parents come there. A lot of parents come to us around 5-6 months, because things that were working for their baby as a newborn and as a young infant is no longer working. So things like rocking to sleep or nursing to sleep, they lay their baby back down and all of a sudden their baby is back awake. Mm-hmm. We have a ton of toddler clients. Really anywhere from newborn to 5 years old, we see it all. And it really is, I think it's more that parents had a system that was working for them and then it's no longer working. And that's mm-hmm. really what we believe is, we say, we respect any parent's decision on how they want to get their baby to sleep, whether they're nursing to sleep or rocking to sleep. But when it's not working, or you're saying, or you as a mom or dad are saying, hey, I can't do this anymore, it's no longer sustainable, that's where we feel like our job is to come in and give you other options.
Yeah, that's such a good point. I feel like we prepare for the infant stage when you're pregnant. It's like you're ready for infancy and you have all the things, you have the tools for sleeping, you have the swaddle, the diapers, you have everything. But then once they hit that, they start transitioning to another phase of out of the womb. It's like, wait a minute, I'm not ready for this. So I can imagine that you would see a lot of clients at that point. You know, I'm curious about some of the things that that you're seeing from families that are common practices or common experiences that a lot of parents face when it comes to sleep, because many times you could feel like you're in it alone. It's like, my child is the only child that gets up 5 minutes after I put him down, or my child's the only one that wants to nurse to sleep. Are there any things that you can reassure us and our listeners about of like, actually, this is pretty common. A lot of people are doing this. And these are some things I see that are common when it comes to sleep with maybe at different stages, newborns, infants, and toddlers.
Yeah. So with newborns, I would definitely say like newborn sleep is different than infant sleep. So it's an active sleep. And then they have a deep sleep. So there's lots of moaning, grunting, moving around. And parents automatically assume if their baby's making noises and moving that they need to jump in and help. But it's actually a phase of their sleep. And so often if you give that baby some time, they will go back into deep sleep. It often appears parents think, oh, they're gassy, they're fussy, they're grunting. And really, it's just the phase of sleep that they are in. Babies can be gassy as newborns at night. And I think it's just that the gas kind of like accumulates throughout the day in their little tummies. But an active newborn and their eyes are still closed, don't rush to interfere with them. As far as infants, like past the, you know, when they come out of that like missed fourth trimester, past that fourth month of, into that fourth month of life, I think what we see a lot of parents is they were doing drowsy but awake in infancy and newborn, and it's no longer working. And the reason it's no longer working is drowsy but awake isn't a real thing, because drowsiness is the first phase of sleep. So it is them going into a sleep cycle. So the parents get them drowsy, lay them down, and then baby is back awake, upset, and they go through this cycle over and over and over again. And so what we work on is how do we teach our baby how to get drowsy on their own? And that's the first step to self-soothing.
Oh.
Yeah. And so it's, yeah. There's a whole, I mean, there is a study of sleep and science. There's a ton of information about it out there. With toddlers, protesting, toddler bedtime battles, protesting. They're learning boundaries, and they do it by seeking opportunities for disapproval while looking for control. And so we as parents have to have loving but firm boundaries and keep those boundaries firm, even though our children are protesting.
Wow. Yes. I'm like, yep, having flashbacks to last night. Like my husband.
Not to last night.
Yes. My toddler, my husband will, he's the only one that can put this boy down. Like when I'm in there, and maybe you see this, like the kids react differently to different parents. With mom, it's absolutely one thing at bedtime. With dad, it's one thing.
It's wild. Yes. Tell us what other mistakes we're making. I'm sitting here thinking to myself, like, okay, set boundaries. And yeah. I remember that stage, drowsy but awake, and all the things that you would do when you think you have it, and then it, nope, it doesn't work. So that's really great to hear. Are there other common things that you see? For me, I'm thinking like transition. So like when kids are transitioning from sleeping in a crib and then going to a big boy bed or whatever. Maybe that's because of the stage that I'm in. But what are some of these mistakes that we may be making when we are noticing that what we're doing is not working and we're trying to fix it?
Yeah. So sleep environment, I think as a parent, is often more fearful to us than it actually is for a baby. So moving from a bassinet in a parent's bedroom or room sharing to a crib to going to their own room, I often say we are projecting a lot of our worry onto our baby, and usually it's not a big transition for them. Obviously, we want it to be a time when the families feel comfortable. Personally, as a mom, for a first time mom, I was like, oh, I'm going to keep my baby in here as long as possible. Around like week 3-4, I could not deal with the active sleep. It increased my anxiety, the movement. I was not my best self. So I had to make the decision for my baby. And for me, it was time for her to go into her crib 5 steps away in the room next door. And I feel like with every baby, it's different, and it's okay as a parent. Like, you're not the same parent you were before you had a baby multiple kids down the road. And so your ideas change, your experience changes, every baby's different. So I feel like we put a lot of emphasis on sleep space. I will actually say when a baby is in the room with you and you're a nursing mother, babies are we're mammals. They are going to smell the milk. They're going to know it's there. So I often say, get the bassinet on the other side of the bed to the non-nursing parent on the other side of the bedroom. And don't always assume every wake up means hunger. And I think that is what a lot of moms go into. I think it's a generational thing that we've been taught by our elders is, oh, a crying baby is a hungry baby. But there are so many reasons why a baby could be crying, and not just always assuming that they need to be fed. And that often leads to an association in the middle of the night of needing food in order to go to sleep. Toddler beds are a whole different beast. I say you can't use a toddler bed to solve one of your sleep problems. It is going to create more problems. So don't say, oh, he's not sleeping well, so I'm going to move him to a toddler bed. Really work on getting those like established boundaries and routines with using like routine cards and rewards charts and colored light hatch, like there's something called like the hatch rest.
Oh,
and
we have that.
Yeah. And setting boundaries that red means bed and green means go. Work on establishing really healthy, age appropriate boundaries before you move into the toddler bed, because it's really hard to bring down those crib walls and say, oh, and we have all these new boundaries. So start working on that before you remove the four walls.
Wow. Okay. I need to pause because we're getting a toddler bed like this weekend. So I need to be like, hold on, don't put it together yet. Yeah. We need to come up with our plan.
And I need to go back in time because that might help. He's struggling. Maybe we need to establish some routines because we just put him in the toddler bed and now he's like been crying for months now. We need to get some routines in place. But that does make me think about with bedtime in your toddler, your infant, whatever age they are, there is, I think a lot of parents feel anxiety, fear, and worry around sleeping, around their kids. For one, there's a lot of messages we get about safety, about back is best, you know, and then also co-sleeping. And then it's nighttime, you're exhausted, but you don't know what's about to happen. There's so much feelings and emotions that surround bedtime for families. Can you talk a little bit about that, Ensley, about like, what are some things that you tell your clients, like ease some of these worries that we have with when it comes to sleep?
Yeah, so many of our clients come to us with like analysis paralysis. Like they have read all different blogs. They follow different Instagram accounts. They have all these, they're trying to solve their problems. And we almost have too much information as our generation of moms. And so that's where I really feel like a sleep consultant comes in and says, let's look at your family where you are, and let's come up with a very specific plan for your family so that we can tackle your worries, your concerns. I think moms, and I try to look back, I'm on a mom of four now to where I was as a mom of one. And I really didn't believe in myself and I didn't have the confidence and I doubted myself. And I just want every mom to know that she is the best mom for her baby. And there is truly a mother's instinct that you cannot deny and you cannot, you feel it in your body. And we have an intuition that I cannot explain when you know something's wrong and not right. So if you ever get to that point where you're just like, this doesn't feel right, whatever I am doing, and this isn't right to the parent that I want to be, then there are other options, whatever that may be.
No, this is so helpful. Oh man.
Yeah. It makes your mind start spiraling, right?
Yes. It does. I'm asking some off the script questions. I'm like, wait a minute. I need to ask about this.
Yeah. toddlers are, they're my favorite age right now, honestly, because I'm about to start working with my toddlers on our boundaries. They're turning to
the twins.
And so I'm about to start working with them.
Are they still in cribs?
They are still in cribs and they will be in cribs until they start climbing out I say until their third birthday, if I can make it happen, they're turning two next month. Oh. Yeah. So we're in a really hard phase right now.
Oh my gosh. They're well, you know, though. I'm really curious about sleep regressions. I feel like, you know, the whole premise of this podcast is that Christine and I go through the same thing, but our experiences are so different. And one thing I have always felt was that sleep was never too much of an issue for my kids. I don't know why. I don't know what I'm doing different. But when regressions hit, that's where it can get really challenging. So some of those regressions are, you know, when they were suddenly walking or crawling and then trying to pull themselves up. I don't know what's going on with the two-year-old right now, but he, you know, does not ever want to go to sleep and he's really resisting it. So are there certain phases where you should expect a regression and how should you prepare for that?
Yeah. So there are like some scientific regressions out there, 4 month, 8 month, there is a 2-year-old regression. It's usually around developmental milestones or how a baby's mind is shifting. And every physical milestone, it's like so exciting to see your baby go through all these changes, but you know, there's, and I like to think of regressions as like a speed bump along the way. So if you have a good foundation of sleep and before those regressions start, you're not going to take a detour. You're going to stay on course. And so I feel like a lot of our clients come to us because they were rocking their baby for the first 3 months of life. And then they hit this 4 month sleep regression, which can honestly happen between 3 months and 4.5, 5 months. Like it is it's a very big span. And they come to us because what was working is now no longer working because their child is now developmentally a different child. And so that is what happens. And so I really talk to parents, like, we're going to expect regressions. We are going to expect a few nights of rockiness when they start rolling, when they start getting on their knees, when they start crawling, when they start, you know, pulling up, when they start. 2-year-olds is a huge language development. There's one around 13, 14 months that is really that I call them like a TABY stage. Like they're going from babies to kind of like toddlers, and they're learning how to protest and how to start demand things. So every regression, I think every developmental phase, I think can have a regression, but it's really what is the base of your foundation of sleep. And if they have that, then they're going to go back to being good sleepers, versus if they don't have that base, then they're going to go and they're going to be a completely different sleeper because they don't have the foundation to revert back to. So my biggest advice is, during these regressions, don't pick up new habits. So if you have a good base and you go through, say, we just went through the 2-year-old sleep regression with my son. He had a huge language explosion. He's not quite 2 yet, but it was definitely it. He would just stand up before bed and just yell any word and every word he could out of his wow. mouth at the end of the night. And I knew exactly what was happening. And he went from like taking 10 minutes to fall asleep to some nights for 30 or 40 minutes, he would still be yelling and talking and rolling around. He was happy as clam, but he was just doing his thing. He would wake up in the middle of the night. He was having a hard time, but I didn't want to go in there and like rock him or start something new. If he was upset, I would go in and like reassure him. I do think it's that is, you know, who I am as a parent. I want them to never feel abandoned or left, which I don't necessarily, I think there's a lot of stuff put onto moms to make them feel that their babies are going to feel a certain way. And we start to project feelings, but I would go in after a few minutes, go in, reassure him and walk out of the room. And I say, as a parent of a baby or a toddler, our job is to help them get calm and settle. Our job is not to get them to sleep. Our job is to allow them to put themselves to sleep. But a calm baby or a calm toddler is who puts themselves to sleep. An upset baby doesn't. So that's where our job becomes, and we help them to calm down.
Right. You know, you talked a lot also, you've mentioned quite often about the foundation that you've established with your children about sleep. And that makes me think about some of the routines and some of the sleep aids or whatever you want to call them, the noise machines, the hatch, the scent diffusers, the swaddle. Mm-hmm. So these foundational things, what are some found, and these are, and I'm mentioning some things that we have done with our children. What's interesting, I think we mentioned this in a previous episode about when they're infants, you have all of these things to sleep for sleep aids. You have a swaddle, you have a pacifier, you have the scent, you have the lotion, you have the massages, all of these things. So I'd like to talk a little bit about what are some of these foundations or some of the routines and aids that you find families use and that actually can help aid children to sleep.
Yeah. So we call them the building blocks of sleep. So we really focus this can start the day your baby is born, is there are 6 things that really can help them start getting into the habits and routines, and kind of think of them like sleep hygiene, just healthy habits in general. As far as any routine around sleep, I like for any routine to be short, sweet, and repeatable. And that kind of goes in, like, I look at me as a first time mom, like doing a bath and doing a massage and then singing a lullaby and dimming the lights and doing the book and all this stuff. And then now me as a mom of 4, it is like change diaper, sleep sack. You're lucky if you got a bath this week and you're into bed.
Yes.
So I have definitely changed. And that's where I say, what do you want as a parent? What's the experience you want? We do lots of books during the day. We do lots of books. You know, we often do it before nap time, but bedtime's so crazy that like they rarely get a book before bedtime anymore. So I think it's really looking at like, what experience do you want as a parent? You know, the biggest things until they start rolling, a swaddle is huge. A baby is born with something called the Morrow reflex, and it will startle them awake. And that is what a swaddle does, is it suppresses that so they can go into a deeper, calmer sleep. After they are rolling, I just say you do a normal sleep sack. You know, the reason I like a sleep sack is it's a signal for sleep. And it allows them to say, okay, mom's putting on my sleep sack. This means I'm going to bed. Plus I think I don't sleep without covers. So this is me actually projecting onto my children. Mm-hmm. So my house is to the temperature where I need covers. So it's going to be to the temperature my children need covers. And you know, we know that safe sleep is no cover, so that we achieve that through wearable blankets or sleep sacks. A noise machine is huge for a newborn. It is because it mimics the sound of the womb. However, as they get older, it's more to block out the ambient noise in your house, your dog, your sibling, the TV in the living room, you unloading the dishwasher. So as they get older, it becomes a signal for sleep, but it's also to block out what else is going on. Because as they get older, around 8 months, they have object permanence, which means they know they are missing out on things. And then they have FOMO and they want to be in on everything. And so that noise machine helps them kind of block out kind of what's going on in the house and allows them to settle down. I don't think you need to have a massage and like have all these different props. I think a pacifier is great. A baby is born with a sucking reflex that is natural. And I think it's just, you have to figure out what works for your baby. And, you know, so I always say, try something, give it a good shot. And then if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. I've had one pacifier kid, one finger kid, and two that just refused it. So I've had a little bit of everything and they're all great sleepers, but it's about being in tune to that baby. And knowing and giving things a try before, like, don't knock it till you try it kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I really like to hear about almost your permission to give people flexibility. Mm-hmm. Like everyone has something to say about you in pregnancy, about how you raise your kids. I mean, in this world, something to say about everything. But I know that when it comes to figuring out the right thing to do for sleep, I remember trying to figure out what other people were doing and feeling like, okay, well, I have to do a bath every night and I guess we have to do a book. So I love to hear almost this permission you're giving to say, do what works for you. Yeah. Now that the other thing that comes to mind with this is having kids sleep in the bed with you. I think that's such a topic that people have strong opinions about. I know for me, it's almost a point of pride that my kids don't sleep in the bed with us. And
for me, it's pride that they do sometimes.
I was going to say that.
Yeah.
Like literally, I'm like, yes, I'm one of those parents who we have our own bed. But like, do you have any comments about that?
It is a hot topic. I will say that there is a side of the parenting spectrum that is like very much co-sleeping, attachment parenting. And then there's the other side, which is like the other extreme is like, cry it out. We're going to leave our baby in our room for the 12 hours and they're going to figure it out. And I think most parents are somewhere in the middle of it. And so I just want to say that just because your child doesn't sleep in the bed with you, doesn't mean your child doesn't have an attachment to you. That is the one thing that really bothers me about a lot of people who talk about co-sleeping and attachment parenting. My children are very attached to me. And sometimes I feel like too much, where I'm like, I'm touched out, I need space, but they still sleep in their rooms at night. And I think every family has to create boundaries around sleep with what is appropriate for your family, for your parenting philosophy. So with safe sleep, we've uncovered so much about SIDS in the last few years, like that there may be genetic indicators or whatnot. And actually, like, we require our consultants to take a safe sleep course every year. And the number one reason we are against co-sleeping at Sleep Baby isn't because it's not great for the mother-baby attachment. So many people across the world do it. One of the number one reasons babies accidents happen is actually like suffocation, like on the couch and things like that. It's not necessarily what we would think of this scary SIDS thing. And so that is really where we come. That's where the safety aspect comes in. We will not work with a client if they want to continue to co-sleep. And the reason is as a sleep consultant, my job is to help your baby or your toddler develop some independence and us give them some space. That doesn't mean you can't cuddle with your child. That doesn't mean you can't have an attachment or a bond with them. But again, if something is working for your family and it is what your family wants to do, I am not here to tell you that is the wrong thing. Mm-hmm. I am personally a mom who cannot have my kids in the bed with me. We actually have like a chaise lounge. If we have a sick kid or something, that is where they go in our bedroom, because I literally cannot sleep. Like I will be there wide eyed with every move and every breath.
That's like I have too at my family. Yeah. And I just want to verify or clarify that when we talk about having kids sleep with us, definitely toddlers and older.
Yes.
We did not co-sleep at all. But
and that's what I wanted clarity on. When you say is co-sleeping, does that entail a certain age or is that an indefinitely?
So co-sleeping is defined. I mean, there are people who bring home their newborns and are co-sleeping from the day that that baby comes from the hospital. Co-sleeping can be defined as a five-year-old in the bed with you. So we won't work with anyone who is co-sleeping because it doesn't give any independence and it relies on someone else as a self-soothing mechanism, which is an adult, whether that is the close proximity, rubbing back, or having to be there. And so it just doesn't allow us to give them the opportunity to be successful and develop those independent habits. But I'm also of the mindset of I can't convince someone that they are ready to work with a sleep consultant. That has to be something you have to come to on your own, because you have to be ready to make changes. And I can't convince you that you're ready to do that. And I think if any client has to be convinced that this is right for them, then they are not the ideal client for us, because they're always going to be questioning in the back of their mind, is this what I want to do? And that's where that confidence piece comes in as a parent. Like, no, I want to co-sleep. I'm okay with them being in my bed with me. They're 4 years old. Like, I'm okay with it. Or like, absolutely not. They cannot be in my bed with me. I need help getting some boundaries that are age appropriate and that we can get our kids sleeping in their own space so I can be my best mom, whatever that may be. I don't think so. Co-sleeping is defined as in the bed sharing, essentially.
Okay. Got it. Yeah. You know, with my kids, and I think, and this is what we were talking about, Renita, is like, we start off, especially with the 2-year-old, start off in your bed, but sometimes he's like waking up in the middle of the night, crying for a long time. It's like, okay, just come on in. I cannot take another minute of crying. But that makes me think about, like, do you think that there's any, like, if there were any things that you said, parents, clients, these are habits that you want to avoid with your children. Are there any things like that, that we as moms of children who are sleeping in our bed or who are learning better sleep habits, are there any things that we should keep in mind as far as like, don't do this?
Yeah. Usually when I start working with a toddler parent, my golden rule becomes don't bring them back in the bed with you. Because toddlers learn through boundaries and so do preschoolers. And so I always give, and it depends on the age. Like if a 5-year-old is terrified of something and it happens once every so often, I've allowed my child to come into the bed with me. If it's an every night thing, it becomes a habit. And so what we don't want to happen is they learn like, oh, if I do this, then my new habit is I get to go into bed with mom and dad. And then mom and dad don't want that habit. And then you can't undo it. And so I always use the analogy of the first time your toddler climbs on top of the coffee table and they look at you and they're like, oh, what's mom gonna do? And if you make a big reaction, they're gonna continue to do it. If you calmly go get them down and are consistent about that boundary, then they're going to stop. It's not going to be an exciting thing for them anymore. Mm-hmm. And so typically I say, if your family is ready to have some bedtime boundaries and have your child sleeping in their own room or in their own bed, I typically say, like, we're going to come up with a plan that involves you comforting in their room. And it's going to be tiring at first, but it's short-term pain equals long-term gain. Mm-hmm. And so, but you're going to have a plan in place. And I think the biggest thing is parents try to plan in the middle of the night. And so what you really need to do is survive one night, wake up the next morning and be like, we're going to be prepared for this. So mm-hmm. I always say we need to be prepared with toddlers for bedtime stalling. We need to be prepared for in the middle of the night wake ups. We need to be prepared when they say they've got to go potty. We need to be prepared when they say they're thirsty. Like, how do we create a boundary that encompasses all of these little pieces? So it's not like they can't throw anything at us. We're like, oh, I outsmarted you here, buddy. And so one of my favorite things for toddlers is having a routine chart.
I was just seeing these all over Instagram lately, like the Velcro.
I haven't seen this or heard of this.
Oh. Yeah. So I do have a little different where I actually, because I do think a lot of the toddler preschool age is seeking boundaries and learning what's appropriate, but then also seeking control, because all day long they're told what to do. And so towards the end of the night, they're really looking for, oh, I want some control in my day. And I'm going to do that mm-hmm. by pushing boundaries and seeing what I can get away with. And then that's going to teach me what I can and can't do. And then I'm going to create new habits based on what I've just learned about my parents. So I actually like giving kids some control at bedtime. So picking a few bedtime routine cards, you can make them. We sell them on our website. You can find them anywhere. And choosing their must-do items, brush teeth, wash hands, go to the bathroom, pick out pajamas. And then you put in the things in there that they want to do or things they use to stall. So if you always read a book or sing a song, make a card for that. And then if they are always saying, oh, I need socks. Okay. We're going to make a card for socks. If they're always saying I'm thirsty, we're going to make a card that says fill up our water cup, whatever it may be. And so when it comes to bedtime, I like to say, lay them all out on the floor and let them choose, make a game out of it, flip it upside down, do like a mystery pull, take turns pulling, like mix it up and kind of make bedtime fun. And then put it in a baggie as they do it. And they know once they're done with their 7 cards, it's time to go to bed. You can also put pieces of Velcro and stick it onto the wall and then have a permanent like bedtime picture. So they can see once they filled up their Velcro that bedtime is there and it doesn't change. But having firm boundaries, we're going to read a book, but we're only going to read 2 books or 1 chapter of a book, whatever it may be. That allows them to have some control, but within your boundary of when this is done and we're finished with our bedtime routine, you're going to bed.
Yeah. That's so funny. You said what they learn about their parents. So their habits are forming based on what they're seeing from us, what they can get away with, what they're discovering, how they can push our buttons, but we need to regain control in those situations.
Yes. Yeah. And it's so hard. Those toddlers, I mean, they are master manipulators and they are learning through everything. And it's like, they're learning through if they throw their food on the floor and you gave them lasagna and they didn't want lasagna and they throw it on the floor and you make them chicken nuggets. They now know that if they throw their food on the floor, they're going to get what they want. And so, and you can't just have boundaries around bedtime. Like you have to have boundaries in their everyday life. Mm-hmm. So I often get parents that are like, the kids run the house. And I say, this isn't going to work. Like we've got to establish some boundaries around other parts of their lives. They go into preschool, they go into kindergarten, they have boundaries. Those teachers are giving those boundaries. They are very clear, but they're
following
firm.
The rules.
Yeah. But they're loving. They're a boundary that's there to help the child. And sometimes we have to think of what's fair for our child. Like, are we expecting something, have an expectation for them, but we're not allowing them a fair opportunity by giving them the opportunity to be successful. So mm-hmm. if we're always expecting our child to be in bed, but every night our routine is different and there's no consistency for them, that's not giving them it's not fair to them because you're not giving them the opportunity to be successful. If sometimes you rock your baby to sleep and then sometimes you want to lay your baby down awake, that's not fair to them because they don't know what to expect. Mm-hmm. So we also have to think about being fair to them by regaining some of that control and putting in appropriate boundaries.
Right. Well, you know, it is summertime and people are traveling, and which means sometimes the sleep is thrown off. We just came back from a beach vacation and I felt so bad some nights because we wanted to go out. We stayed out later and the kids were so cranky, so tired. And also it was a different time zone. So now we have these different things. It's like sleep and we're in a different environment. The bed situation's different. What recommendations do you have for maintaining consistency when the bedtime routine or nap routine is different or thrown off?
Yeah, I think if you plan ahead and you know where your day is going to be thrown off. So I say try to only have like one or two hiccups a day. So whether that means if you know that nap is going to be on the beach and on the go, okay, what can we do to make that comfortable for the baby? Can they nap on our chest? Can we bring a fan? Can we have a portable noise machine? But could they possibly sleep in a little bit more in the morning? Or could, if we're going to stay out late, could we do a cat nap on the way to the restaurant and everyone else go in the restaurant and we sit in the car for an extra 5 or 10 minutes? With toddlers, it gets a little tricky because sleep helps regulate their emotions. And so, you know, I do think toddlers really need naps in order for parents to survive vacation. But sometimes that may mean nap is later so you can go to dinner later. So I think it's a little bit of give and take. And if you look at your whole day, say, okay, we're not going to throw everything off the whole day, but maybe just one piece here and there. And then also when it comes back to coming home, I call it vacation detox. Like, we have grandparent detox and we have vacation detox when it comes to sleep. And so,
oh my gosh, grandparent detox. This sounds like a, yes, I need that.
Yes. It's an actual detox. You get the sugar with out. Food.
Yes. So with vacation detox, I say it takes a couple of days to kind of get back on the routine, but really come in from your vacation very rigid, like restart and be rigid when you return. So if you're rigid when you return, it allows a more flexibility when you're gone. Sometimes if you're going one time zone difference, sometimes it's not worth changing your child's time zone for a week vacation because it takes about 2 to 3 days to get adjusted. Then they're adjusted for 3 to 4 days. And then you've got to come home and do another detox for 3 to 4 days. So we often travel into central time zone from the Eastern time zone. And when we do that, we don't even change our children's time zone because, you know, there's no point. We just wake up early and go walk on the beach. And like, you know, we go to bed like super early. We will have nights we stay out late and we just kind of know that we're the sacrificial lambs, you know, like we just know, we expect for it to go bad. And if it goes well, we're pleasantly surprised.
Yep. Perfect for me. As I'm thinking about the vacation we're going on in 3 weeks, we're going to the beach with the kids.
Yeah. And it's a different central time zone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I say take things like, so for an infant, there's really some great things. Infants are obviously the easiest on the go. I think parents are often fearful of that, but like, there are some great new inventions. I mean, they make blackout curtains that suction cup to the windows that are portable and roll up. There's something called the slumber pod, which is a blackout tent you can put over a pack and play. There's a lot of great travel things that can really assist with a good sleeper. I think the toddlers are the ones that have the hardest time because they are so emotionally driven, but then they're also curious and want to know what's going on. They're aware they're in a different environment. And so I feel like that piece when traveling with a child is a little bit harder than traveling with someone under the age of one.
Right. And like you said, they don't want to miss out.
Exactly. And sometimes as a parent, you don't want to miss out. So you're like, we're going to nap on the beach because I want to sit on the beach and I want to read my book. And so if that means you're laying on my chest, then that's what you're doing.
Yep. You'll just have to do that. Enjoy the sun.
But on that day, like if I was saying, okay, we're going to sacrifice nap, that wouldn't be a night I would go out to dinner. Mm-hmm. That would be, I would go out to dinner another night where I say, okay, we're going to have a good nap in the house.
That's perfect. Well, I'm so excited to use all of these tips. I'm like thinking about transitioning into the big boy bed. Jackson's been getting up because of what started off as nightmares, but now obviously is just the routine of wanting to cuddle with mommy at 5 a.m. So I got some homework.
I mean, but does it ever end? Is there ever a point when kids are going to just be great sleepers like the parents that love sleep, love and miss sleep so much?
Yeah. So there are some studies that have been done. So there is like the, eventually they'll sleep. It's usually around the age of 5. So it's a long time if you think about like, and that's with like no sleep training, no working on good sleep habits. It's typically between like 5 and 7. And so that's a really long time as a mom. If you don't thrive without good sleep, that's a long time to go. I could personally never do that. I lose one night of sleep and I have to take a nap the next day. Yes. I am a monster. Like, it is a joke between my husband and I, like if one of the kids is sick, he knows the next day, like I am going to make an hour period to like recharge, take a nap. Yes. Because otherwise I am so frustrated come dinner time. I'm exhausted. I'm running on empty fumes and it's not so what's needed. Best for our whole family. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's good to know. I mean, half a decade is a long time to wait, especially. Yes. Half a decade.
Way to look at it.
Yeah.
That puts it into perspective. But no, I mean, that is a silver lining, I guess, is that you have that. And I mean, outside of that, we have this episode, we have these tips, and also folks can get in contact with you. We'll be sure to include that information because, I mean, this is just the tip of the iceberg, I'm sure, of what can be experienced if folks are really struggling with sleep or do want to help their kids regulate and have a restful night's sleep is by meeting with you. It seems like you all have some great resources on your website as well. So we'll certainly push that link out, but this was incredibly informative. I've been feeling like kind of tugged and pulled emotionally, like myself, like, oh my gosh, why did I do that? But I know it's not too late. And hopefully you can vouch for this. It's never too late to start the right thing with your little ones.
You are exactly right. It is the time is when you are ready. And so if you are feeling like, oh, I need to do something, it is never too late.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for joining us. We're so excited to talk to you today and lots of great tidbits to help us get our kids to bed.
Yes. This was so fun.
Yes. Thanks, Ensley.
Thank you so much.
Don't forget to subscribe to our podcast so you don't miss a thing and leave us a review. You can also follow us on Instagram @thecradleandall or email us @thecradleandall@gmail.com.